In this lecture, we will go over the CFA Level 1 reading on options, markets and contracts. This is a long reading with lots of learning objectives. We will talk about basic definitions of call options and put options. We will illustrate different types of options contracts. Section 3, the structure of global options markets, talks about exchanges and over-the-counter markets. Then we get into different types of options, as we've seen in earlier parts of derivatives. Types generally refers to the type of underlying. So we'll have options that are based on currency, options that are based on stocks or bonds or an index. And then finally, Section 5, principles of option pricing, which I think is perhaps the most testable aspect of this reading. Basic definitions. Broadly speaking, we have two types of options, call options and put options. A call option gives the holder the right but not the obligation to purchase the underlying asset, whereas a put option gives the holder the right but not the obligation to sell the underlying. Given that the holder of the option is getting an option or getting a right, the holder needs to pay for that option, and that amount that he pays is called the value, or sometimes it's called the premium. The curriculum generally refers to that as the price of the option. This is paid at the initiation of the contract. Let's talk about options in a little more detail now. An option will always have a strike price or an exercise price denoted by X. These two terms are synonymous. The strike price or the exercise price is the fixed price at which an option holder can buy the underlying. And here we are talking about a call option. Let's say that our underlying is one stock of General Electric. The option contract, again, is a piece of paper which will give the holder the right to buy the underlying. Let me give a simplistic scenario first. This option contract will define the strike price. Let's say the strike price is 25. It will give a maturity date. Let's say that the date is 31st December. And obviously, it will specify the underlying, which is General Electric. There will be other pieces of information, but what I have given here is the basic content of the contract. What this means now is the holder of this contract has the right to buy the underlying share for $25. Let's say that this is a European style option which can only be exercised on 31st December. And at 31st December, the price of the underlying is 27. The long party, or the party which has purchased this contract, will benefit because the long party will pay 25 to the short party and get the underlying. The long can then go sell the underlying in the market for 27. So effectively, the payoff is $2 in this simple scenario. I talked about a European style option. An American style option is one where the holder can exercise the option on any day before the maturity date. So if it is 30th September today, and the holder wants to exercise this option, he can, as long as this is defined as an American style option. Coming now to put options. The put option gives the holder the right but not the obligation to sell the underlying asset. Again, let's assume that the underlying asset is General Electric, the strike price is 25, and the maturity date again is 31st December. If on 31st December the price of the underlying is 27, then it makes no sense for the holder of the option to exercise, because if the holder of the option or the long party goes to the short and says, okay, I want to sell to you for 25, that doesn't make sense because the asset is worth 27. So the holder of the option is better off selling in the market at a higher price. On the other hand, if the price had gone down to say 20, then the holder of the put option is happy because the market price is 20 and the holder of the put option has the right to sell for the strike price of 25. In this particular scenario, the payoff is 5. Let's go over some examples of options. Let's say that it is 13th June and we are looking here at the closing prices of options on Sun. The stock price on this day is 16.25. What you are looking at here is 8 different options. So each one of these is an option. Let's make sure we can interpret these numbers. July calls trading at 2.35. This is the price of a July call option where Sun is the underlying stock and where the exercise price is 15. So the contract will look something like this. We'll have the underlying, which is specified as Sun. The exercise price is 15 and there'll be an expiration date at some point in July. This is trading for 2.35. An October call, which is expiring later. So everything is similar except the expiration date. And notice, since the expiration date is further out in the future, the price of this option is higher compared to the price of the July call. Let's look at the puts now. The July put is trading at 0.9 and the October put is trading at 1.85. Again, notice that if the put is expiring further out in the future, it has a higher price. With an exercise price of 17.50, the July call is worth $1, and this is worth less because the call gives the holder the right but not the obligation to buy the underlying at the strike price. The right to buy the underlying at a higher strike price of 17.50 is less valuable compared to the right to buy the underlying at a lower price of 15. On the other hand, with puts, the right to sell at a higher price, so the right to sell at 17.50 is worth more than the right to sell at 15. So hopefully that makes sense. The next item we will talk about is moneyness. An option is either in the money, out of the money, or at the money. If an option is in the money at expiration, that means that the option will be exercised. If the option is out of the money or at the money, then it will not be exercised. So let's go back to the same example. 13th June, stock price 16.25, and we need to identify the options below as being either in the money or out of the money. The quick way of looking at call options and deciding whether they are in the money or not is to compare the stock price denoted by S with the exercise price denoted by X. If the stock price is greater than the exercise price, then the option is in the money. So if we look at the stock price 16.25 and compare this with the exercise price of 15, then the call options are in the money. So the July call options, October call options, where the strike is 15, are both in the money. What about 17.50? So these are another set of call options where the exercise price is 17.50. These options are not in the money because if you look at the stock price of 16.25, that price is less than the exercise price of 17.50. So these are out of the money. With put options, again, you compare the stock price with the exercise price, and these options are in the money if the stock price is less than the exercise price. And we can go back to what I said earlier, where the holder of a put option is happy when the stock price goes down because he has the right to sell at a given exercise price. So in the context of the put option, he would want the stock price down so that he can sell at the relatively high strike price. If the strike price for the put options is 15 and the stock price is 16.25, the right to sell at 15 doesn't really help the holder of the put option because he would rather just sell at the market price of 16.25. So these two options then are out of the money. What about the put options with a strike price of 17.50? The stock price is only 16.25 and the right to sell for 17.50, which is more than this, means that the put options are in the money. Coming now to the structure of global options markets. Broadly speaking, options are traded both on exchanges and on over-the-counter markets. On the left, we talk about over-the-counter options markets. As with forward markets, these consist of a network of dealers who create the OTC market. Dealers can take either a long position or a short position, and if they are not happy with the exposure they have taken, then they can hedge that exposure by taking an opposite position with another party. In the OTC market, the contracts are customized. They are private transactions. Since these are private transactions, there is credit risk. The OTC market is largely unregulated. You can take a look at Exhibit 3, which shows you the major dealers and end users for different kinds of options contracts. On the right, we take a look at attributes of exchange-listed options markets. Here, we are dealing with standardized options. The exchange defines all terms except the price. On an exchange, an option can be bought or sold anytime prior to expiration. Now, this is not to be confused with American versus European options. The idea here is that the contract is a very liquid instrument. So you might have a contract which is a European option, but this particular piece of paper is being traded on an exchange. So you can buy and sell this contract. It is a liquid market because we have standardized contracts. You can compare this with futures markets. There is essentially no credit risk. Most trading happens on options which are close to being at the money. Options which are very far out of the money are generally not as heavily traded. And let me just clarify what this means. Earlier, I talked about an option being in the money. So if we take a call option, that means that the stock price is greater than the exercise price. Being at the money is where the stock price is equal to the exercise price. When the stock is trading at a price which is very close to X or the strike price, we say that the stock is close to being at the money. And this is where there is the largest uncertainty about whether the option will end up at expiration being in the money or out of the money. And it turns out, for various reasons that you don't need to worry about, that most trading is happening on options which are close to being at the money. Another piece of general knowledge is that on exchanges, an option contract typically covers 100 shares of a given stock. In my earlier example, I simplistically identified an option where the underlying was one share of General Electric, but generally one contract which is traded on an exchange will have 100 shares as the underlying. Section 4 now, different types of options. And as I mentioned in the introduction, the different types of options are identified based on the underlying. So with stock options, the underlying would be a stock. With index options, the underlying would be a stock index, and so on. We will focus here on financial options. We can also have options on futures, where the holder of the option will have the right but not the obligation to take a position in a futures contract. We can have commodity options where the holder of the option might have the right to buy an underlying commodity such as oil at a given price. And then we can also have various other types of options that we do not need to worry about at this stage. Let's talk about stock options, index options, and bond options. Stock options are also called equity options, and as I have mentioned several times, the underlying here would be a stock or some form of equity. With index options, the underlying is an equity index. On the Chicago Board Options Exchange, the S&P 500 index options are traded, and these are quite popular. Here, the underlying obviously is the S&P 500 index, and as we saw with futures markets, this contract also has a multiplier, but the multiplier here is 100. All that means is the following. Let's say that the strike price is equal to 1500, and at expiration, the index is at 1501. So the holder of a call option, the long party, is in the money at expiration. The benefit is 1, but that benefit is multiplied by the multiplier of 100. So the holder of one option will get 100. If the holder has two options, then he would get 200, and so on. Bond options are primarily traded in over-the-counter markets, and the underlying is almost always a government bond. The calculations for payoffs, though, are practically similar to what you have seen earlier, and we'll do a small example on this later. Let's talk about interest rate options now. Borrowers use interest rate call options to hedge risk of rising rates on floating rate loans. Hence, the underlying payment is generally made when the underlying loan expires. Before going into some examples, I'll just explain this very briefly. As with other kinds of options, an interest rate option gives the holder the right but not the obligation to do something at expiration. If we have an interest rate call option, this gives the holder the right to borrow at a given rate at a given point in time. The holder of a put option will have the right to lend at a given rate. Now, let me give you a simple scenario, because as mentioned over here, generally call options or interest rate call options are used to hedge the risk of rising rates on a floating rate loan. Let's say that you are a large corporation and you are dealing with a floating rate loan. We are here at time zero, and this is a long-term loan where you are making a loan payment based on LIBOR. So this is a floating rate payment, and you are concerned that on the next reset date, so let's say that this is end of period one, this is end of period two, you are concerned that at this next settlement date, LIBOR will be high, which means that your payment over here will be high. So how can you hedge the risk of that high rate, which will result in a high payment? What you can do is go long on a interest rate call option. So let's consider this interest rate call option where the underlying is 180 day LIBOR. So let's say here that each period is 180 days. You are sitting here right now at time zero. What you can do at time zero is take a long position in an interest rate call option where the call option expires over here and the underlying is 180 day LIBOR. So here we have it. The option expires in 180 days. The exercise rate is 5.5%. What that means is that at this point in time, so end of period one, let's say this is day 180 relative to point zero, no matter what the rate, you have the right but not the obligation to borrow at 5.5%. With interest rate options, we have to specify the notional principal. Let's say the notional principal here is 10 million. Now at expiration, the rate, let's denote that by S, is 6%. The strike, as we've shown here, is 5.5%. This option now is in the money because the holder of the call option has the right to borrow at 5.5% and the market rate is 6%. So clearly this option will be exercised. The next question then is, what is the payoff? The payoff is 0.5%, but this 0.5% is an annualized number and we are talking about a 180-day period. So we need to take 0.5% into 180 over 360, or essentially half of 0.5%, and multiply that by 10 million. This number gives us the payoff amount, and that number is 25,000. What is mentioned up here is that the underlying payment is generally made when the underlying loan expires, and this is a little different from FRAs where we calculate the present value and settle over here. With interest rate options, generally we don't do that. We just settle at the end of the loan because this amount is being used to hedge the extra payment that is being made on the loan, which I talked about earlier. So just to make sure we clearly identify the answer, the payoff for the long call is 25,000 and that money is received at this point, which is the end of the underlying 180-day loan. Now, what about a put option? Let's consider a very similar put option where the underlying is 180-day LIBOR. The option expires in 180 days. So again, all the numbers are similar, but we now have a put option. And I'll also clarify who might use this. Here, imagine that you are an investor. So in this example, we took the perspective of a company which has either issued a bond or a company that has borrowed money and needs to make interest payments. Here now we take the perspective of an investor who is receiving payments, but is receiving payments based on a floating rate. If you are receiving payments based on a floating rate, your worry now is that interest rates might go down. To hedge the risk of rates going down, you might buy a interest rate put option where you benefit from this option if rates do go down. So let's look at the situation here. The option expires on day 180. So option expires over here. The underlying is 180-day LIBOR. So the underlying is this loan over here. Effectively, with a put option, you have the right to lend at the exercise rate. So here the exercise rate is still 5.5%. So you have the right to lend at 5.5%. We need to specify a notional amount. At expiration, the actual market rate is 5%. So S here is 5%. Market rate is 5%. You have the right to lend at 5.5%. So the put option is in the money. The benefit again is 0.5%, which is an annualized number. We de-annualize and multiply by 10 million. The benefit is 25,000 as before, and that benefit is received at the end of the 180-day loan. Interest rate options and FRAs. As you might have figured out, both interest rate options and FRAs are used to hedge interest rate risk. There are a few subtle differences that are going to be highlighted here. Let's consider a 3x9 FRA priced at 5%. What does this mean? And this is a quick refresher of what you studied in the reading on forward contracts. If we are here at time zero, a 3x9 FRA expires at the end of period 3. And if each period is a 30-day period, then it expires here on day 90. And the underlying hypothetical loan expires at the end of period 9. Again, assuming 30-day periods, we have a 180-day period over here. So the underlying is 180-day LIBOR. Priced at 5% means the long party has the obligation to borrow at 5%. Notice with an FRA, no matter what the rate might be at this point in time, the long party has to borrow at 5%. If rates are high, let's say rates are 6%, the long party will benefit and will borrow at 5%. If rates are low, say 4%, then the long party on a FRA loses out because the long party still needs to borrow at 5%. Calculate the payoffs assuming the following interest rates at expiration: 4%, 5%, 6%, and we'll use a notional principle of 100 million. With the FRA, the payoff is going to be minus 490,196 at this point in time, at T equal to 3, which is where the FRA expires. Now, how did we get this number? We've seen the calculation earlier in the reading on forward markets. Notice that the market rate is 4%. So the long party on the FRA has to borrow at 5%, which is the FRA rate. The long party loses by 5 minus 4, which is 1%. So the loss is 1%, but that 1% is an annualized number. Over a 180-day period, we take half of that number, which is 0.5%. So the loss is 0.5% of 100 million, which is 500,000. That 500,000 would be at the end of the hypothetical loan. And as you might recall, with FRAs, we normally settle over here where the FRA expires. So we calculate the present value using the market rate of 4%. So 500,000 is discounted at 1 plus the market rate of 0.04 into 180 over 360, deannualizing, and I get this number. With an interest rate call option, and given this rate at expiration, the payoff is zero because the holder of the call option is not going to exercise the option. The holder of the call option will simply then borrow at the market rate of 4%, which is lower than the strike price or strike rate of 5%. What if the rate at expiration is 5%? Then in both scenarios, the payoff is zero. If at expiration the rate is 6%, then the long FRA is going to benefit and the payoff will happen at expiration of the FRA. With a interest rate option, the benefit is going to be 500,000, and as we've discussed, this amount will typically be paid at the end of the underlying loan. Now you might wonder, why would anybody go with a FRA given the two-sided payoff? If rates go down, then the long party loses. If the rates go up, the long party wins. So this is actually called a two-sided payoff. Whereas with an option, we have a one-sided payoff where the holder of the option benefits when rates go up and doesn't have to pay anything at expiration if the rates go down. The answer is that this interest rate option will come at a price. To purchase this option at time zero, the holder of the option has to pay some money. Whereas to get into a forward rate agreement, the holder or the long party does not need to pay any money. Next, we talk about interest rate caps, floors, and collars. And before I go into the definitions and the learning objectives specify that you just need to know the definitions, this material is covered in a lot more detail at level 2, where there is a full reading on interest rate options and derivatives. So I'm going to set the context, give you the definition, you learn this and move on. Generally, these options are used to hedge interest payments on floating rate loans. So let's say that we have a floating rate loan where an interest payment needs to be made at the end of every period, say these are 6 month periods, and let's say that the interest rate payment is based on LIBOR. So each one of these dates is a reset date where the interest payment at the end of period one is defined by LIBOR at time zero. The interest payment at time two is defined by LIBOR at period one, and so on. which means that at time zero, we know the interest payment over here, but we don't know what the interest payments would be in the future. Our risk is that LIBOR might go up, which means that the interest payments will become higher. To hedge that risk, we can go long on a series of interest rate call options. And that series of interest rate call options is called a cap. Each individual call option is called a caplet. And hopefully it is obvious from the way I have set this up, but each option should expire at the date on which the floating rate will be reset. So given that the floating rate will be reset over here and that new rate will define the payment over here, our first caplet should actually expire over here. The second caplet should expire over here and so on. Also, with a cap, each option will have the same exercise rate. So we might define an exercise rate of 5% and that needs to be the same for each caplet. Notice that when rates go up, then you will benefit because of this cap. So if rates go up, your payments on the bond are higher, so that is bad, but that higher payment on the bond is compensated from the benefit that you get from the cap. With a floor, you can take the opposite perspective. Imagine you are an investor. You have invested in a floating rate security. So you receive interest payments. Those interest payments are based on LIBOR. Your risk is that LIBOR will go down, which means that the interest payments that you receive will come down. So what you can do is purchase a floor, which is a series of put options where the underlying is an interest rate. And each individual put option there is called a floorlet. Notice here that if interest rates do go down, then on the bond, you are losing out because you are receiving a lower payment. But on the floor, which is a series of put options, you will actually benefit because on a put option, you make money when the rate goes down. Here, if the strike is 5%, that means that you have the right to lend at 5% no matter what the market rate. So if the market rate goes down to 3%, your benefit is 2%. Again, you would lose out on the floating rate bond that you have invested in, but that loss would be compensated by the benefit that you get on the series of put options. As with the cap, the put options should expire on the reset dates, and all the strike prices of the floorlets should be the same. A collar is a combination of a long cap and a short floor. So that's one way of creating a collar. The other way of creating a collar is a short cap and a long floor. I'll briefly describe this, and again, this material is covered in detail at level 2, and you can also find some of my lectures on YouTube where I give some examples on this material. But I think that from a level 1 perspective, given the learning objectives and given that all this is just explained in a couple of paragraphs in the curriculum, I don't think you will be tested on the mechanics of how this works. All right, so anyway, the collar is a long cap and a short flow. The simple scenario is this. Go back to imagining that you are a large company, you issue a floating rate bond. Your risk is that interest rates will go up and you will have to make high interest payments. To hedge that risk, you buy a cap, which means that you effectively cap your interest payments at a certain amount. But buying the cap costs money, and you might want to offset that cap by selling a floor. When you sell the floor, you get money, and some or all of that money might compensate or cancel out the payment that you made for the cap. With the cap and the floor, you effectively create this collar where you will have a certain rate, which will be the maximum rate that you would pay, and a floor, which would be the minimum rate that you might pay. And again, don't get too hung up with the mechanics at this stage. Currency options. Most currency options trading happens on over-the-counter markets. A currency option allows the holder to buy an underlying currency at a fixed rate, and the price of that underlying is expressed as an exchange rate. So what I just described is a call option. Just to give you a very simple example, let's say that you get into a options contract. So we have a call option where the strike price is 1.2000, the underlying is the euro, and this price is expressed in dollar terms. You have the right to buy, let's say, 10 million euro at $1.2 per euro, and you have the right to do this on 31st December 2013. What we've done here is defined a very simple European style currency option. When do you benefit? You will benefit from this option if the euro goes up. Let's say that the euro goes up to 1.3. You will have the right but not the obligation to buy each euro at 1.2. And in fact, you will have the right to buy 10 million euro at $1.2 per euro. This will benefit you as long as the euro ends up being above 1.2. In my scenario, if the euro is at $1.3, then that will be good for you. On the other hand, if the euro dips and ends up being at 1.1, then the call option will not help you, because the right to buy each euro at 1.2 will be useless. You can buy in the open market at 1.1. This is a call option. A put option would be the option but not the obligation to sell. You could sell the underlying for, let's say the strike price is 1.2, then you will have the right but not the obligation to sell the underlying currency at $1.2. Like currency forward contracts, currency options are very popular. And I think you can probably figure this out. What are the major pros and cons of using currency options versus using forward contracts? As we saw earlier, the benefit of using a currency option is that you can exercise the option if it suits you. If you got into this call option and the euro went up, you would exercise the option. On the other hand, if the euro goes down, then you would simply buy euro at the market price of 1.1, and you would not need to exercise the option. That's the benefit. The negative is that the currency option will come at a cost. So nobody is going to give you the option for free. You will have to pay a reasonable amount for that option. And the amount that you need to pay, the valuation, is something that we will discuss at level 2.